This video will contain the notes for working with complex numbers. Remember what we learned, that in math, the letter I is defined as the imaginary unit, where I is the square root of negative 1. You have to know this fact. I is the square root of negative 1. So, if we're going to work with this, what's going to happen if we square I? Well, if we square I, then we have the square root of negative 1 squared, which should be negative 1. What we're going to do is we're going to deal with patterns in powers of I. So what happens if we keep taking I to exponents? Well, we can use these patterns to simplify radical expressions. And we have to remember that we're dealing with things with I's or negatives under square root. We have to simplify first because an exponent is a radical, and a radical is an exponent, and that comes first in order of operations. After that, we're going to go through with the rest of the order of operations, add, subtract, multiply, or divide. So let's start out and fill in these patterns for the different powers of I. We started out, I is the square root of negative 1, which is just a plain old I. I squared. I squared is the square root of negative 1 squared, which we said was negative 1. I cubed. Well, we know that I cubed is I times I squared. So we can put our two things that we had together up above. I is just I. I squared is negative 1. And the answer to this one is negative I. I to the fourth. I would think of I to the fourth as I squared times I squared. So that's negative 1 times negative 1. And negative 1 times negative 1 is positive 1. So far, we know that I to the first is I. I to the second is negative 1. I to the third is negative I. And I to the fourth is positive 1. What happens if we keep getting bigger exponents? I to the fifth. Well, I to the fifth can be broken down into I to the fourth times I to the first. I to the fourth was just 1. I to the first is just I. So 1 times I is I. Again, I like that I to the fourth. If I want to simplify I to the sixth, I to the sixth is I to the fourth, and I'd have two more I's left in. So I to the fourth is 1. I to the second is negative 1. And 1 times negative 1 is negative 1. I to the seventh. I can get one group of I to the fourth in there, and then I also have I to the third that I would have left to make a total exponent of 7. I to the third is negative 1, or sorry, negative I. So I have 1 times negative I, which is negative I. I to the eighth, now I can get 2 I to the fourths. So I have I to the fourth times I to the fourth, which is 1 times 1, or just 1. So if I wanted to continue my pattern over there on the right in generalizing what's happening, I started out, I to the first was I to the second was negative 1, I to the third was negative I to the fourth was 1, I to the fifth is I to the sixth is negative 1, I to the seventh is negative I, and I to the eighth is positive 1. So hopefully we should see that this pattern is going to keep repeating itself. I's are never simplified if they have an exponent. We can always take an exponent from the I and simplify it down so that we have only a single power of I in my final answer. So what if I wanted to come up with a method for simplifying I raised to an exponent? Well, I like I to the fourth. So the first thing I'd want to do is to divide the exponent into groups of 4. When I do that, each group of I to the fourth is 1, so I can ignore them. I only really care about the ones that don't go evenly into a group of 4. So this is the remainder when you divide the exponent by 4. So let's look at example 1 here. If we're trying to simplify I to the 25th, my exponent is 25. So I want to take my 25, and then I'm going to divide that into groups of 4. Well, 25 divided by 4 is 6. But what I have left at the end is 1. This 1 is I's exponent. That's my remainder. So what I have here is this one I that doesn't go into a group. This is the same way of representing that up here. I have 6 groups of I to the fourth, and then this one extra I here that doesn't fit in with the rest. So the 6 groups of I to the fourth is just 1. And then I have the extra I, leaving me with a final answer of I. Remember, my final answer, I can never have an exponent in it. Pause the video while you try to simplify I to the 39th. So I need to break my 39 into groups of 4. So I have 9 groups of I to the 4th. Really, that part doesn't matter because that's just going to be 1. All that really is going to impact me here is these 3 that I have in the remainder that are going to be left over. So far, I have I to the 3rd. Well, I'm not allowed to leave I to the 3rd as an answer to my problem, so I need to simplify that a little more. I to the 3rd was I squared times I. I squared was negative 1, so my final answer for this problem is negative I. If you turn the page, we're going to look at some ways that we can simplify using these powers of I. For a complex number or a complex expression to be simplified, you must have the following things in order. You can never leave a square root under a radical. You can never leave an I with an exponent. You can never leave a radical in the denominator on the bottom of a fraction. You can never leave an I in the denominator. We'll really avoid that one. And we have to follow all the other rules for simplifying. So let's put these into practice, starting out here with example 2. In example 2, we're supposed to simplify the square root of negative 12. Well, the first thing we need to realize is that we have to simplify first. So the first thing I need to do in this problem is take this and break it apart, because the square root of negative 1 is I. So I need to take that out from underneath the radical. Then I'm going to go back and I'm going to simplify 12 just like I used to. 12 is 4 times 3. 4 is 2 times 2. So I can take a 2 out in front. I still have the square root of 3 left underneath. You can write your answer as 2 square root of 3i, but the way we normally write it is 2i square root of 3. The important thing is that the I is not underneath the square root, and it's a little more obvious that it's not underneath if we write it out in front. Pause the video while you try to do this, simplifying the square root of negative 54. The first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to take the I out from underneath, and I'm going to make that out in front. Then I'm going to break down 54 into its factors. I have a 3 that can come out in front. I already had an I out there, and I still have a 2 and a 3 left inside. So I would write my final answer as 3i square root of 6. All right, let's look at example number 3. In example number 3, I'm simplifying 3 times the square root of negative 50x cubed. Again, the first thing I want to think of is that this negative underneath here can be thought of separately, so I know my final answer needs to have an I in it. Then, I also want to break down 50 the same way I always did. I can take a 5 out from underneath the 50, so that comes out here. I still have the 2 left inside. I also had x cubed, so if I have 3 x's, I have a group of x's that come out to make a single x, but I still have an x that's left underneath because it doesn't have a partner. And then in my final answer, I had the 3 that was already out in front combined with the 5 that's now out in front makes 15. I have the I have the x, and then underneath the radical, I had the square root of 2x. It doesn't matter if you write the x and the I or the I and the x, it's the same thing. Pause the video while you try to simplify 2 times the square root of negative 98x to the fifth. The first thing I'm going to do is take the I out, no negative underneath the radical. Then I'm going to factor 89. I have a 7 that can come out from underneath the 89, but I still have a 2 that's going to be left inside. I also have 5 x's. With x to the 5th, I can take out 2 groups of x's, so I'm going to have x squared outside, but I still have an x left inside. My final answer is to just put these factors together, So I have 14 outside, I have x squared, and I have underneath the radical the square root of 2x. In example 4, we have a multiplication problem. In this one, it's really important that we go back and look at our order of operations. Remember, the first thing we have to do is to simplify the square root of negative 27 and the square root of negative 21. So to simplify the square root of negative 27, first I'm going to take out an I, then I'm going to break 27 down into its parts. I have a 3 that can come out in front, but I have a 3 that's still left underneath. When I go to simplify the square root of negative 21, I'm going to take that negative and bring an I out in front. I could try to break down the square root of 21, but 21 is 3 times 7, so I have nothing that can come out from underneath there. I'm going to put the two outsides together. I have 3 times 4, which is 12 out in front. My I's together make an I squared. And underneath, I have 3 times 21. I probably wouldn't multiply those together because the next step is going to be to break down their product. So I have a 3 that can come out, and that's this one here. I still have a 7 that would be left underneath. On the outside, I've also taken my I squared and turned it into a negative 1. So now on the outside, I have a total of negative 36, and on the inside, I still have my 7 underneath the square root symbol. Pause the video while you attempt the U-try for example 4. I started out on this one to simplify what was under each of the square roots. The square root of negative 72, I broke down over here, and I was able to take out a pair of 2s, a pair of 3s, I took out the I because there was a negative underneath, and I still had a 2 left inside. When I went to simplify the square root of negative 30, I could bring the I out, but 30 was 2 times 3 times 5, so I couldn't take anything out there. In the next step, when I put these together on the outside, I had negative 2 times 2 times 3, which was negative 72, also with that 6 in there, sorry. Then I had the I and the I together as I squared, and I could put the 2 and the 5, or the 30, which was both underneath the square root, together to make the square root of 60. In the next step, I converted my I squared into a negative 1, and I simplified the square root of 60 into 2 square roots of 15. For my final answer, a negative times a negative is a positive 144, and I had the square root of 15 underneath. For example 5, we're simplifying the square root of negative 8 over 5. Remember, I can put the square root as 2 separate square roots with the division of them both. Next, I want to simplify the square root of negative 8. I can bring an I outside because of the negative, and 8 was 2 times 2 times 2, so I could take a 2 out in front, and a 2 is left underneath. I still have the square root of 5 on the bottom. I'm not allowed to leave the square root of 5 on the bottom of the fraction. To get rid of that, I need to multiply the bottom of the fraction by the square root of 5, so I'll have 2 5s underneath, and I can take a 5 out. I can't just put a square root of 5 on the bottom of a fraction. The only thing I can multiply a fraction by is 1. So I also have to multiply by the square root of 5 on the top of the fraction. And now the top of the fraction is 2i square root of 10. I cannot simplify the 10 and the 5 because the 10 is underneath the square root and the 5 is outside of the square root. So that's my final answer. Pause the video while you attempt the U-try for example 5. To simplify this one, I simplified the square root of 12 into 2i square roots of 3, and then to get rid of the square root of 7 on the bottom, I multiplied the top and the bottom of the fraction by the square root of 7. So on the top, I could combine my square root of 3 and my square root of 7 to make a square root of 21, and on the bottom, I had 2 7s underneath my radical now, so I could take them out. And there's my final answer, 2i square root of 21 all over 7. On the bottom of the page, I just wanted to give you a quick reminder. Remember, the square root of negative 1 is I. But going back to what we learned in the past, the cubed root of negative 1 is still a negative 1 because a negative 1 times a negative 1 times a negative 1 is a negative 1. So just because we see negatives in the problem doesn't mean there's necessarily going to be an I. We're going to have to think about whether or not the I should be there. In the square root of a negative 1, those are the problems that will wind up having I's in them. Whereas if we have a cubed root of negative 1, that will have a negative answer instead. All of the examples we just did had square roots of negatives, which gave them I's. However, a lot of times when we're performing operations with complex numbers, like we're going to on this page, we'll have I's, but we don't necessarily have a radical or a square root symbol. So what we're going to do in these examples, we're going to look at adding, subtracting, and multiplying complex numbers. When we're going to do that, we're going to treat the I just like any other variable, like it were an X. Then in the end, we're going to simplify using the patterns and the powers of I that we did in the front of the notes. Remember, never leave I to an exponent. For example 6, we're supposed to simplify. We have a complex number, 2 plus 3i, minus another complex number, 5 minus 3i. Remember, when we're subtracting, the subtracting gets distributed to both of the terms after it. So it would become a minus 5 and a plus 3i. Then I go to combine like terms in the end. I have 2 that has no letter with it, minus 5 that has no letter with it, go together to make negative 3. Then I have my i's. I have plus 3i and plus 3i combined to make positive 6i, and that's my answer in complex number form. Pause the video while you do the you try for example 6. In this one, I distributed my subtraction, which wound up with a negative 8 and a negative 5i. Next, I need to go through and combine my like terms. I have a positive 3 and a negative 8 together make negative 5. I also have a negative 2i with my negative 5i makes negative 7i. My answer in complex form is negative 5 minus 7i. In example 7, we have the addition and multiplication dealing with the complex number. Again, if this problem had x's in it, the first thing that you all would want to do is to distribute the 3i, and that's the exact same thing we're going to do with complex numbers. When I distribute, I have 3i times 6, which is 18i. I have minus 3i times 5i is 15i squared. At this point, since I have a 15i squared, I'm going to replace that I squared with a negative 1, and what I really have on the end here is now plus 15. Let's look at the other numbers too. I had my 18i, which is still 18i. I could group it together with the 2i I already had to make a total of 20i. And then I also have my 4 that was out in front, which can now be combined with my 15 that was on the end to make a total of 19. Pause the video while you do the you try for example 7. So I started out, I distributed my 5i cubed. Then I replaced whenever I saw I to a power. I to the third was negative I. I to the fourth was positive 1. Last, I simplified. I multiplied my 10 times negative I to get negative 10i, and my 15 times 1 to get 15. And in the final step, I combined like terms, combining my real number part, 3 minus 15 was negative 12, and my imaginary part, negative 5i minus 10i is negative 15i. Example 8 is a multiplication problem. We're multiplying 15 plus 3i times 2 minus 4i. When I like to multiply two binomial type of expressions like this, two things with two terms, I like to multiply using the box method. Some of you prefer to use FOIL. Either way, we're going to get the same thing. 2 times 15 is 30. If I'm FOILing, that's my first two. For the next one, I have 2 times positive 3i is plus 6i. That's my inside from FOILing. I have minus 4i times 15 is negative 60i. That's my last if I'm FOILing. And I have negative 4i times positive 3i is negative 12i squared. And that is my lasts. If I take these numbers out of my box and write them in a row, I have the same thing. Last, I need to simplify. When I'm simplifying, I have an I squared on the end here, which I want to replace with a negative 1, making the end a positive 12. I also wanted to combine. I have a plus 6i and a minus 60i, which I combined to make minus 54i. And then the last thing I'm going to do in this problem, I have my 30 and my positive 12 that can be put together to give a real number part of 42, making my final answer 42 minus 54i. Pause the video while you try the example for number 8. Remember that when we square a binomial, it's the same thing as multiplying by itself. So for this, I either need to FOIL or do boxes. For this example, I used the boxes and got all 4 of my products. Then I wrote them out in a line. I combined minus 6i and minus 6i to give me minus 12i. I also replaced I squared with its value of negative 1, making the last term really a minus 4. In my final answer, I grouped together the 9 and the minus 4 to give me 5, and my imaginary number part was minus 12i. Number 4 talks about conjugates. The conjugate of a plus bi is a minus bi. So, with numbers plugged in, the conjugate of 3 minus 5i is 3 plus 5i. The conjugate of 4 plus I is 4 minus I. So, you try. What is the conjugate of negative 7 plus 3i? Well, we have negative 7 and we have 3i. When I find the conjugate of a number, all that changes is the sign that's in between them. So, my answer, what is the conjugate, would be negative 7 minus 3i. When I have two conjugates, the only thing that's different is the sign in the middle, the sign in between them. We just learned this word conjugate, and now we know what it is, but what is a conjugate useful for? Well, something unique happens when we multiply two conjugates. In this you try, it says simplify 2 plus 3i times 2 minus 3i. So give that a try, multiply those two things together either by FOILing or doing boxes and simplify your answer. When we multiply two conjugates, something special always happens. Since the terms in the middle had opposite signs, one will be plus and one will be minus. Since I used the same numbers to get them, they'll always be the opposite, negative 6i, positive 6i. They're going to balance each other out and make 0. So the part with the i's will always disappear. On the end, I also had to simplify, and I had an I squared, which made the end plus 9. And my final answer is 13. Well, what's special about this? I started out with two complex numbers with imaginary parts. Two things in the problem both had i's in them. And once I multiplied them, what happened? My answer was always a real number. More specifically, this number is also always going to be a nice integer. That is, unless the numbers that you multiplied together that were conjugates had fractions in them, so if they were rational numbers to begin with, if we started with something like this, and we multiplied it together, our answer would then be rational, not an integer, because it might have a fraction in it, just like our original problem did. The biggest deal is that when we multiply these two together, we never have an I left in our answer. We always turn to a real number. Try the practice problems on the next page, and when you're done, you can look at the answers. You can pause the video while you check your answers to 1 through 4 and 8 through 11. If you have any questions, come in ready to ask them in class tomorrow. Here are the rest of the answers. You can pause the video again while you check them and let us know tomorrow if you have any questions.